The demolition of Joe Louis Arena will symbolize a lot of things for the Red Wings. The farewell to the legends that played there, the banners of glory hanging in its rafters, and the revered aura of the stadium itself. But to me, it symbolizes one thing. The official end of the Red Wing Empire. Don't get me wrong, this empire has long been dead. Over the past few years, the organization has been desperately trying to keep up the facade of the former glory that it had instead of recognizing its flaws. It's a franchise merely existing in a vegetative state, like Rome before it. The Red Wings are an entity merely siphoning whatever reputation it had for the sake of its immediate and long-term future. Anything to remind themselves of their glory in the mid-2000s. The constant over-reliance on scouting Wunderkind Håkan Andersson, trotting out the same old stars they had years ago in a feigned attempt at being competitive, but they still are forward-thinking. They promoted from within to replace Mike Babcock with Jeff Blashill, one of the more revered coaching prospects in the league at the time of his hire. Unfortunately, to say he sucks is a total understatement. Red Wings fans want him banished to Windsor on a daily basis. To be fair, I don't think they even want him. Their postseason streak finally was put to an end after last year's abysmal season, but their legendary status was long but a distant memory. Their so-called promising stars are either not as good as hyped to be, stagnated in development, or regressed so badly that they didn't score a goal until the final game of the season. Ken Holland now runs an organizational train wreck with a bleak present and future. But where did everything go wrong? How did one of the league's model organizations become such a joke? For this, we have to find the moment that began the decline of the empire. If you are familiar with TV jargon, there is a term called jumping the shark. It's when a show has that moment when it begins its downward spiral into cancellation. The term is named for the show Happy Days, where the Fonz literally jumps the shark, a moment which began the show's sharp decline in quality. This thinking can be translated into the sports realm as well. Some moments are easy to identify, like the 49ers firing Jim Harbaugh, the Islanders with the John Spano saga, James Dolan becoming majority owner of the Knicks, Canucks fans rioting after losing Game 7 of the finals in 2011. For the Red Wings, it doesn't have to do with Datsyuk or Lidstrom retiring. It doesn't have to do with Babcock leaving either. The man is a great coach, but he hadn't taken the Wings anywhere in a while, and his views on concussions are, shall we say, Neanderthalian. For this, we have to go back to the last decade. During this time, they had a rising star in the managerial world as their vice president. You may have heard of him. His name is Steve Yzerman, legendary player for the organization, beloved by ownership and the fanbase, slowly learning the ways of the empire to help it better adapt to the new NHL world. It was eventually realized that Yzerman was the future, and he should become the team's emperor as soon as possible. This is when the franchise savior Mike Ilitch went to Ken Holland and asked him to move to a higher position away from day-to-day operations. Ken Holland, of all people, knows loyalty. He will reward the team that turned him into a legend. He refused to budge.
Right there! That is the moment when the Red Wings organization jumped the shark.
Of course, Ilitch isn't going to fire Holland for refusing to leave. The man has a stellar reputation, and the hockey world would have been outraged at this decision. And to replace him with a guy who has minimal experience, the feathers of the boys' club would have been ruffled. Nothing was done. Yzerman, sensing that his time would not come with the Wings, despite his love for the organization, accepts a GM position with the Lightning. But the Red Wings were still in good hands. Holland was one of the league's best GMs throughout the late 90s and 2000s. The Empire will continue to reign supreme. Remember when the Wings had Vojislav Salming and Bernie Federko for that 1 year? It's time to bring back the magic. Mike Modano, lead us to glory. Todd Bertuzzi is aging rapidly, but still producing? Extend him! Nicholas Cronwall is one of our legends. It's time for a nice reward. 7-year contract on a $4.7 million cap hit. Physical defensemen don't fall off of a cliff, right? I mean, look at the contract we gave to Zetterberg. $6 million cap hit until he's 40. What a stud. We have the new heir to Lidstrom, Ian White. He sucks too. It's not like he shit on Bettman or anything, and he... Shit, we need to block the prospects from making the team. How about Carlo Koliakovo, Jordan Tutu, and bringing back Mikael Samuelsson? That'll do it. How were we supposed to know that would happen to those three fucking nerds? Remember that Kyle Quincy guy we told to fuck off a few years ago? Turns out he's good now. Let's reacquire him for a first-round pick. That pick turned out to be Andrei Vasilevskiy. Is this supposed to be reparations for refusing to budge for Yzerman? It's okay, let's sign Quincy to an extension.
In fact, we're on a spending spree. Jimmy Howard is a rock. Have some money for 6 years, boy. Jim Neal is a Red Wing for life. He will never leave us. That Modano signing worked out so well for us that we need to bring in another legend. Even better, a Swede. Danny Alfredsson, baby! We locked up Johan Franzen to a nice 11-year deal. This won't backfire on us. Nope. Not at all. We now have the future replacement for Datsuk, Steven Weiss. The hell do you mean he gets injured a lot, sucks chunks, and has to be bought out? Get out of here with that garbage! Dan Cleary has settled into organizational cheerleader very nicely. Let's overpay him for another year. And again. And again. Jonathan Erickson is a nice third-pairing defenseman nearing the end of his prime. Let's overpay the shit out of him. And have a complimentary no-trade clause for the trouble. We need to keep the streak alive at all costs. Time to trade for washed-up David Legwand. The streak is alive! We need to keep the streak alive at all costs. Time to trade for washed-up Eric Toll. The streak lives!
It's so beautiful.
We need another old man because our prospects haven't gestated for 5 years yet. Brad Richards, come on down. The fans miss Lidstrom, huh? Well, how about Mike Green? He does things. Have a shitload of money. The glorious streak continues with one playoff win. A brilliant send-off for Datsuk. Time to reward our great players. Justin Abdelkader is really starting to develop into a nice top six anchor. It's time for the local boy to get a payday. 7-year extension at a $4.2 million cap it for fucking Abdelkader? We can't have Darren Helm leave. Who will be your assistant leader on injured reserve? $4 million for 5 years should do it. Now we have the replacement for Datsuk. 32-year-old Franz Nielsen. He made the All-Star team, though. Long live the Empire. Danny boy, just write a number on this blank check with the number of years you want. We will do the rest. Have a no-trade clause, too. Luke Glendening is a nice find as a fourth liner. And you signed him to a bloated extension. Drew Miller is still here? Didn't he get cut a few years ago? And the streak is over. Maybe they'll realize the course they're going on will lead to disaster. Nah, that wouldn't use too many brain cells. Let's go all in on Trevor Daly. At least Athanasiou is a good player. Nice depth piece to aid a playoff contender. And you don't have the cap space to pay for him. And he's fucking off to Russia. What has occurred with the Red Wings over the past decade is the slow and painful decline of a once mighty empire. The Senate became complacent, refused to adapt to an ever-changing hockey world, and the barbarians sacked countless cities as a result. Ken Holland chose to play the fiddle and overpay the majority of his players for reasons of continuity. This unfortunately doesn't work when your so-called legions of prospects are nothing more than smoke and mirrors, or if they get poached by other organizations by trades or waivers. And the sad part is that this fate could have been avoided. When Iserman left for Tampa Bay, he took some of Detroit's scouting staff with him. Suppose Iserman takes over for Detroit. Now imagine the Red Wings potentially having Andre Palat, Tyler Johnson, and Nikita Kucherov. Instead of overpaying to keep Jonathan Erickson, they sign Anton Strålman. Instead of trading it, they keep the 2013 first-round pick and select Vasilevsky. The Empire could still be going strong. Even for his faults, Steve Yzerman turned what was the joke of the NHL into a Stanley Cup contender. This could have been the Red Wings if Holland accepted the owner's wishes. Instead, he became stubborn and chose to cling on to what made him great in the early 2000s. Take the Patriots, for example. They are cold and ruthless with how they approach player transactions and retainment, but they do it for the greater good. Look at what loyalty has gotten you. A perennial 10th place finish and borderline cap hell. You see, Red Wings, you're not just going to be mediocre, you're going to marinate in it. Its cold, unforgiving grip slowly draining you of all hope in life until you are a soulless husk. Even worse, there's no hope of change anytime soon. Holland still believes that this team could make the playoffs. Let's say they actually do make it. Then what? The sweet reward of getting blown out in the first round by a division leader? You aren't getting past a 7-game series with a bunch of middle six forwards and defensive anchors. Lidstrom and Fedorov sure as shit aren't walking in that door anytime soon.
Sadly, it gets even worse. The man that saved your franchise from oblivion, he's gone. Another symbol of the fallen empire. Like many emperors of Rome, Kris Ilitch is nothing like his father.
Chris only cares for the bottom line. Chris only believes in appearances of competence. He doesn't have the passion for sport like Mike did. Your future is as bleak as Detroit itself. You're going back to the early 80s, the Dark Ages, a time when the Red Wings were a directionless, poorly run car crash. This team has done the unthinkable. They've gone from the envy of the league to its newest punchline. Hockey Town will become Hockey Hell. For those of you that may think I'm being too harsh, here's a disclaimer. Nobody is questioning Ken Holland's legacy. Regardless of his terrible stretch, the man will continue to go down as one of the best GMs of the 2000s. In fact, I find Holland to be more of a tragic figure. To me, he is Gwyn, Lord of Cinder, a former god who has sacrificed everything that he has known and loved to try and maintain the fires of his past glory in the Empire. He may have been egotistical in refusing to move aside, but that's because he felt he could still remain on top. He was grossly mistaken. This is the harshest lesson to learn. We all have an expiration date. One day the world will pass us by and we shall become obsolete and irrelevant. Different ideas and theories will come along, and unless you can adapt at rapid speed, you will die. No matter how good or important a person is, we are all replaceable cogs in the machine. What happens when you don't adapt? You become the Red Wings. Man, this video is quicker.
That one gloved down by Erickson. Bildered ahead now, and Nyquist, oh my, he's run into by Bolin. Right back ahead comes Seabrook with a shot. He scores!